So I get the delights of sitting down, partly because I've got a dodgy back, so apologies for me sitting on the floor. I thought what would be really interesting, me and Sean, Kevin's first met back in the 80s. We both lived in Camberwell at the time, and we'd often kind of sit there playing records to each other. And I think we both discovered loads of really interesting stuff off the back of it. Ian, this mic is feeding quite a lot on the stage, and so maybe just cut it out, and then when John speaks, just pop it in. Might be a good idea. There you go. We lived in Camberwell Grove. You lived in the top end of Camberwell Grove. We all drank in the pubs in Camberwell.
Tavern down the
bottom. No, not the Tiger. No, that's
to do.
The Hermit's Cave. Brendan and the Hermit's Cave. That was just basically a whole kind of late 80s, early 90s scene, wasn't it?
What was kind of interesting was, I suppose, the diversity of stuff we ended up playing each other. You kind of think back what was probably cool back in those days. I remember sitting listening to, well, one of the tracks we're going to play in a minute, but things like K.D. Lang, Ingenue.
Yeah. I remember Nick played me that first K.D. Lang record, and I just thought, wow, there's something really interesting about a record that is obviously a country record, but it's made by a very unusual person, a real individual, but the playing was quite unusual, quite beautiful. It didn't feel like country. The playing didn't feel like country, but it was like a lovely melodic record. And I think that was about the time when I was sort of making Apricots and Santa Barbara record, so
yeah,
that made sense.
Well, right? I remember you giving me a copy of the first album, the High Llamas album, which I think is the first, you did on Demon.
Yeah, I mean, that's a strange one. That's when, at this stage, John and I were both in Micro Disney, and John was pulled in back into this. He thought he'd get away, thought he could go and just basically, you know, have a life without. But you were dragged in, weren't you?
Yeah, those early days of the High Llamas. We were listening to Alex Chilton.
Alex Chilton was huge.
That was a massive thing.
The band.
It was like Americana. It was the slightly weirder end of Americana, was it, at that point?
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, that frequency. The thing is, we have to contextualise this. The late 80s and the early 90s was basically being geared up for like Seattle, and there were two things happening. Seattle was getting that was beginning to sort of become the coolest place on the planet, and the Bull and Gate was just kind of turning out lots of sort of strange bands from Midlands, had strange old names,
and populated itself. Ned's Atomic Dustbin.
It was lovely and it was whatever, but we just didn't feel like we had a home there, so we were kind of making these kind of power pop records, I guess, that were influenced by Gene Clark and the Byrds and Alex Chilton, and listening to really weird things like Glenn Branca as well, and Hell Mel and things like that.
But I think that was the interesting thing. We were, there was no sort of, we can't play that because, that doesn't fit. I think there was a lot of people were starting to go down those rabbit holes of, I'm only going to listen to one thing. And I think what was refreshing was we were both listening to such a mix of music back then.
Absolutely. It's a frighteningly long time ago.
well, you know, you change in your response to what's going on around you, and you change in response to what your youth is, what your childhood is. I mean, I remember thinking, wow, I'm getting around this music again, and my God, Micro Disney, that was so long, that huge long time. And before Micro Disney, you know, we were totally the pop group, and my God, that was so long ago. But of course, it's only 10 years. It's a very short amount of time.
Yeah.
But when you're young, 10 years feels like a really, really long time.
Yeah.
And we're still in early 30s and sitting in your front room eating one of your beautiful curries. and Mixmaster Morris is in the other chair.
Yeah, who was my flatmate at the time. And when I first met him, the reason I moved in, I'd never seen a record collection that was as big or as eclectic as mine. And that's what I kind of, you know, that vibe was totally mine. So I thought what we'd do tonight, we're going to start you a bit gently and play a few tracks, which I guess musically I feel as if, you know, certainly there's bits of this that, you know, I could hear within the High Llamas. And then we'll move on to a bunch of influences, which are certainly more current and fit very much with the new album. So I thought we'd start with, many people have heard of this, but it's a group called Millennium from 1968. They were kind of classic sort of baroque sunshine pop band. They were led by a guy called Kurt Bircher. I never quite understood how to pronounce his name, but I went and checked it the other day, and apparently it's Kurt Bircher. So can we just have a maybe 30, 40 seconds of this first track? I think the reason I wanted to pick this track is not only there's some slightly odd sort of connections with the Beach Boys and Gary Usher, who was kind of involved in all of this. And I thought the Beach Boys was probably a bit too obvious, because I think you all know Sean's love of them. But, you know, what was it around all of this sort of scene that initially got you musically?
So obviously the Beach Boys is the way in for all of us. All of us who listen to that sort of slightly gothic West Coast experimental sound, definitely the Beach Boys is the way in. Brian Wilson was surrounded by a coterie of people, Terry Melcher, Gary Usher, Mark, and then there were other people who were making records, like obviously Paul Williams and Mark Eric. And there were some absolutely amazing records made that I guess were made in the tide of the Beach Boys, in those days record companies put money into obviously the Beach Boys had just become this enormous band, and so another band comes along, and you know, I've got this sunshine pop band, and I've got these crazy ideas, and they're slightly psychedelic, and you've got record companies saying, yeah, come on, let's do it. So these records were made. Of course, nobody bought them.
No.
And they just disappeared. But these guys thought this was, you know, this was going to be huge. And these records were genuinely odd. They had, I think their influences were a little bit of kind of, a little bit of folk, a little bit of the Birds, and a little bit of, you know, the Beach Boys and what the Beach Boys were listening to. Like the, you know, the Four Freshmen, etc.
Yeah, because I mean, Kurt was originally in the Association.
Yeah, who were absolutely.
Another one of those sort of vocal groups from LA.
Yeah.
Which, you know, were really common back then.
And of course.
Well, and the thing that they've kind of all got in common is they're at the core of them is three or four brilliant singers.
Yeah.
So Harper's Bazaar, and then you put that together with a producer coming out of psychedelia, and you get this really interesting
plan. And Van Dyke Parks, the writer and the arranger Van Dyke Parks.
Yeah.
So he's a common thread, like he's there. So we're probably only talking about a group of, you know, 30 people.
Yeah.
You know, running up and down the West Coast, LA, San Diego, you know, San Francisco. But because the sound is so distinctive, they feel as though they're bigger.
I mean, I just love that track particularly, because it's got sort of a Latin American rhythms to it, and you know, their ability to kind of mix things up in what was still sounds a bit like pop music.
Yeah, I mean, the little bit that we heard where you think that this little kind of shuffle is going to carry on, and then suddenly it just changes chord, and it just goes into this lovely choral moment. With a slightly soaring vocal.
Yeah.
And the writing was really, I mean, obviously, you know, in the East Coast, there isn't much like that apart from maybe the Left Bank, Michael Brown montage.
Yeah. Yeah.
Of course, there's probably loads of things we don't know about.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think most of it's probably reissued in some way, shape and form these days. But it was quite staggering when I started hearing some of this stuff in the kind of late 70s, early 80s. I was lucky enough, I got quite pally with Julian Cope, who, when he was off on tour in America, used to send me, I was still at university, he would send me brown envelopes, you know, full of records he bought for 50 cents in some charity shop in you know, Mission District or something. It was quite phenomenal. The next record I thought we'd play is something you actually brought round to mind one day. And, you know, it really caught me. I knew a little bit of Brazilian music, but I really didn't know very much. And Sean came around very excited one day, and we stuck on this, it's the next album, which, back then, fortunately, there was a guy, I think, at Tower Records in Piccadilly Circus, who was buying up lots, quite cheap reissues, or maybe current issues. Well, there would have been reissues, because there were CDs. So all of a sudden, being able to get hold of a lot of these Brazilian records was quite amazing. But can we play a little bit of the next track? Which I think is quite short as it is.
Is it loud enough out there?
Yeah. I mean, what caught me, I think, the first time you played me that was not just the vocals, which, you know, I wasn't kind of used to, but the way it shifts musically.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. So that was written, that's Milton Nascimento, and it was written with a guy called Lo Borges from an album called Club Esquina. And there were two Club Esquinas, Club Esquina 1 and 2. And Club Esquina is a really groundbreaking record. It's really even in the Brazilian idiom, it's made, I think it's made about 71, 72 maybe, and Tropicália is pretty much gone
72,
by then. And so this guy comes along, Milton Nascimento, and he's known as the Black Sinatra. That's what they call him.
Wow.
In Brazil. Yeah, they said, yeah, because he basically, his range was incredible, and he crooned. He had a great baritone and he had a great falsetto, the one thing that he was a huge Beatles fan, a massive Beatles fan, he was as I said, he co-wrote with Lo Borges. They were childhood friends, actually, and Club Esquina was their childhood secret club, believe it or not. That's why the cover, is you know, two little kids crouching in a favela, it looks like.
So was he part of, because I know a lot of the Brazilian musicians, when things got really hairy in Brazil, came over to the UK. Did he spend time over here?
He wasn't massively political, and he avoided being deported or dispatched by the junta. I know I think, I don't know what he was doing during that time. I mean, obviously, the big names in that time were, you know, Gilbert Schiller and Catano and Gal Costa. Mm. And slightly before that, it would have been Nara Leo and Joe Gilberto, etc. So you had the beginnings, the bossa nova, and then you had the politicization of Tropicália. And the craziness, you know, Mutantes, and then in the early 70s, you know, it's another group of people. One guy who's there throughout the whole thing is Jorge Ben.
Yeah.
Right from the beginning, you know, right from the sort of late 50s when he's making these sort of strange little dance records, right through to the early 70s when he's making these crazy records about his Christianity and, you know, and... just beautiful, and you know, Afrobeat records, yeah. And, you know.
But that passion you had for Brazilian music to continue today. I mean, you've worked with Caetano's son,
yeah, Moreno, Gilberto Gil, did some strings for him, yeah.
And Domenico Lancelotti, have I pronounced that correctly?
Domenico, wonderful man, who will be in London in April playing. And Moreno's in London in April as well. They're both here. So these guys, Domenico and Moreno and Cassin Camar, those guys are in their 40s now. They're sort of the new generation of young Brazilian producers who really brought Brazilian music back to its roots, because you probably realize that after the Tropicália thing, you know, Brazilian music didn't, you know, it's a strange thing when a country is aware of its culture and is aware of its music, but doesn't always celebrate it. And for years, basically, really, really crazy heavy metal was basically what was happening in Brazil. And Brasilia, the actual capital of Brasilia, was the capital of this crazy thing. And these Cassin and Domenico Moreno were the guys who basically started, you know, working again with some of the older guys and basically grabbing, you know, this Tropicália sound back and bringing it back to Rio.
One of the things that was an influence, and you hear it in that track on the High Llamas, was kind of all the Brazilian musicians from the 70s, from that era, they're very happy for the time feel of the music to follow the melody they've written. So if the melody's longer than 4 beats or whatever, they just add two more beats, add extra bars. So there's loads and loads of odd time bars. It was really, I think, that around that time that we started doing that as well, and you started doing that in the way you wrote.
Well, that's a good observation, John. And obviously chords as well. The chords, you just discover a sort of a world of chords. The guy who brought me to that, this was Philippe Auclair, or sometimes known as Louis Philippe. He's the guy that really brought me there. And then another guy called Thomas Papon, who still works as he's from Sao Paulo, and he works for the BBC, he's a journalist. Yeah. Okay. And he was the, like, he just basically educated me. And once, you know, I was like, you know, once we went there, we were just there big time. And I mean, you know, it's and the thing about, again, Brazilian music, it's not just about Joe Gilberto and Bossa. You've got the whole African sound from Bahia, Recife, which you can hear in the Milton Nascimento tracks. Those polyrhythms come directly across from West Africa.
No, totally. I think that's what I always found fascinating.
Yeah.
You could hear little bits of things which seem to have come from somewhere else, but the way they put it together, and still are today. I mean, some of the most fascinating music I've heard in the last couple of years again comes from Brazil.
Yeah, absolutely. Anna Faranga, is that? Amazing, fantastic. There's a wealth of young musicians. They're just making incredible music right now.
I think it's about time Rough Trade had a good Brazilian section. That would be great. Because some of the records are just impossible to find. I mean, you know, sadly, you're stuck with Spotify these days. The next track goes back a couple of years from this, although the musician who made it had been around for a pretty long time, was making music, I think, before the war, before the Second World War, certainly just after. And again, I think it felt like something which I can hear seeping into the High Llamas music. So can we have a bit of the next track, and we'll explain who it is in a second. A guy called Basil Kirchen, which I had to go and look up, and it's had a fascinating life. Got to say, wasn't something. Where did you first come across it? Was it via Stereo Lab, or
no,
was it something you just
Johnny Trunk? Johnny Trunk, who I'm sure a lot of people know who Johnny Trunk is, Trunk Records. I'm sure they listen to his show on Resonance every now and then. Johnny Trunk single-handedly revived the memory and the posthum. Reputation. Thank you. He basically went into Basil's loft,
okay,
and found masses of library tapes and recordings, and reissued everything on Trunk. Basil was a drummer. He started life in his father's band. I can't remember his dad's name, but he was the big band. It was, somebody might know. Anybody know was Basil Kirchen's father?
No. Ivor.
Oh, okay, there you go. And he was the drummer.
There's a lot of Ivors back in those days.
Yeah. He was in the he was the drummer in the big band, and then he cut free and created his own little band, which was basically a brass section. It was just like seven horns and Basil playing crazy drums. But he was also really interested in cutting up tape, and this is like at the same time as, you know, in the US, and you know, you've got people like Terry Riley cutting up tape in France. Mm-hmm. You've got what's his name, Boulez, you know, what's his name,
Pierre Henry.
He's cutting up the tape, yeah. So he's not calling it music concrete, he's just calling it crazy stuff that's in my head. He starts making library music at KPM.
This track's from a KPM.
And then he starts, he doesn't really have an artistic career, but he does have a soundtrack career. And, you know, he makes his biggest soundtrack, I guess, is Dr. Fibes, horror, and then I Start Counting.
Very disturbing British film.
Absolutely, yeah. Jane Asher, yeah. So we're drawn into this by Hull 2017, Year of Culture. I'm visited by these two lovely chaps. They said, "You're the only person out there talking about Basil Kirchen, apart from Johnny Trunk.
Okay.
And would you like to write some music which reflects the work of Basil Kirchen?" Because Basil ended his, basically spent the second half of his life in Hull, and they claimed him. They basically claimed him from London or from Soho, and said, "No, he's a Hull."
Cool.
Yeah. And I mean, he ended up making records in Louth, in Hull, outside Hull, sorry, in Lincolnshire.
Yeah.
Is
that where Robert Wyatt lives?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, yeah, same place. We wrote this bit of music, and I put this band together with Johnny, Marcus, Dominic,
and a harp.
Seraphine Astaire, Dominic from the Llamas, John Telfer on tenor,
Tim
Gain from Stereo Lab, and we made this crazy record, this crazy performance, which has never been recorded, and will get recorded. Which basically was, imagine if you if Basil was around now, and we kind of tried to kind of write in try to get inside his head and write And we finished with I Start Counting, the tune, yeah, with Jane Weaver on vocals. And it was a beautiful, lovely memory. And that was,
it's amazing music. And again, you know, think back 40 years ago, you wouldn't have heard this stuff. It's just amazing how, you know, people like Johnny Trunk allowed this stuff to leak out.
It was all over British TV, this music. And the great thing about, you know, TV in the 60s and 70s was, you know, if you didn't like what was on, if you listened, there was just some incredible music being made. And yet again, you have this fantastic thing whereby the producers and the program makers don't understand what's going on. And so they just think, well, these guys are the jazz guys and whatever, and these guys are actually experimenting on British TV shows. Yeah.
So much of it was anonymous. I don't know whether anyone's heard of a guy called Pete Long. Pete Long at all?
No.
So I was lucky enough to meet Pete Long when I first came to London, and he taught me quite a lot of music. And Pete Long was a guy, he was from the British jazz scene of the 60s, and he used to turn up to rehearsals on a motor scooter with a massive box of music elastic banded to the back of his motor scooter. And I wonder, I was talking to him and said, Pete, what's the most successful bit of music that you did? And he said, Asteroids is mine. And I said, what is Asteroids? And he said, it's the Pearl and Dean.
Oh wow!
Yeah, yeah. Which is a mind-blowing piece of music, and the guy is anonymous. You know, that is a genius bit of writing. Yeah.
No, I think there was a lot of characters around that time who were, you know, just lost. I kind of hope that, you know, one of these weird channels on Sky will start showing a lot of these old movies from the 60s, because there's some amazing
John
stuff.
Baker and obviously Delia Derbyshire.
Yeah,
they all fall into that.
Yeah. So anyway, we're going to go flying into the now next.
Yes.
Be curious to see how many people recognise who this is. So if we can maybe have a bit of the next track. Just coming in.
Just coming in. Oh, a little bit more of that, maybe. Maybe a tiny bit. Yeah.
For those of you who don't know, this woman is headlining Glastonbury on the Friday night. And she's called SZA, spelled S-Z-A. And when I first heard the first album, I just thought, wow, this is just amazing. And I think one of the things that's been really staggering over the last few years, and I think it's weird that both me and Sean have got kids roughly of the same age who seem to be playing some of the same records. But, you know, from kind of what I thought about maybe R&B 20 years ago to where it's got today, really has changed. So that track, by the way, is also, she's got a few names on it, so it's Pharrell Williams, Neptunes, Ty Dolla Sign. So,
yeah. It's really beautiful. Pharrell's very much, you know, present on that. I think the thing that strikes me about that particular tune and about a lot of modern R&B is the musicality of it. Mm. It's a mistake that a lot of us people from our generation make, and they just think that R&B, there isn't a musicality in R&B, you know, it's about something else, it's about something outside your experience, or it's about beats, or it's about the visceral, but it's incredibly musical. And the production techniques, the very contemporary production techniques, you know, the tuning of the voices adds to the musicality, doesn't take away from it, it totally adds to it. And you're quite right, Nick, you know, probably 2014, 2015, I'm exposed to this stuff, as you are now, with your son Harry, by my kids, Livy, and Livy's a big part of it, and Finn, And other people like there's a May Robson, who's an artist called May, who's a current R&B artist. She starts playing me so much stuff, and it's really weird. Here Come the Rattling Trees is being made at the time. I'm sort of thinking I'm thinking about Basil Kirshen an awful lot. Here Come the Rattling Trees, by the way. The reason why that got made is because I certainly didn't feel as though, as a songwriter, I had any relevance or much to say, you know, in just going in and making a record. So I wanted to write, you know, something for the stage. I think it was you encouraged me to do it.
To write a musical.
Yeah.
It was your fault. It was a great idea.
Yeah. And so I thought, well, you know, you can become relevant by writing for the stage. And so we wrote for the stage. It was. And it was a great thing to do, but just after that, this kind of beautiful sort of awareness of modernism in music just starts to stun me,
yeah.
and suddenly go from being somebody who's unclear about what to do and where to go,
yeah,
to being kind of very clear and but quite afraid, because, you know, I'm 64 years of age and I'm not, you know, it could feel like appropriation or embarrassing. Yeah. So but then, you know, it took a few years to actually get out there and do it.
Yeah. Got it. No, I mean, it's, you know, the new album shows how much you've kind of picked up from a lot of that music that was coming through. And I think what's really interesting is a lot of British acts, and we're going to go to one of them next, all of a sudden we started hearing homegrown R&B for the first time, and that wasn't just kind of frothy Top of the Pops type stuff, but was actually going in some interesting directions. So we're going to have the next track is by a British duo, I think, two brothers, called Jungle. And the track is called Casio.
Casio, playing on my heart, just like a Casio. Waking third apostle, looking ready to go. But we don't know the year, that's not original. I'll send a call, all right, let's go now.
You can certainly hear pointers from what had been before, but they're playing with it in a really interesting way.
Yeah, I mean Jungle, they're from West London. They're Shepherd's Bush guys. They're not brothers, but they're childhood friends. They basically learned to play music by playing PlayStation, and I think they were exposed to R&B and disco, and, you know, 70s disco, and, you know, an 80s electro. Playing video games. So they put together this incredible act, which is, I think, very contemporary, very modern, but it absolutely is just great modern disco. And they've just had a huge hit called The Summer of 74, I think it's called. And if you've ever not seen these guys, go on YouTube and have a look. What the thing that is amazing about them is they their music is visualized by dancers, and they have series of incredible dancing extended dancing theater moments where it's just the marrying of the two, the, you know, the vibrancy of young dancers and the vibrancy of this music. I mean, is just incredible.
Yeah, I mean, Salt did, if you're familiar with Salt, I think the first time I bought a Salt record was in here, and it was in the kind of post-punk section, I guess, because some of the tracks may have reminded people about ESG, who were, you know, an interesting band that Tony Wilson at Factory put out a single. But Salt did their first ever live show, and they did it in the old IKEA up on the North Circular. And each room, they used all the different rooms, and they had loads of dancers with lots of different themes. I mean,
I think a lot of people were shocked when they saw the ticket price. I think it was about 80 quid. But the experience, I wish I'd gone, but...
If you don't know, I mean, Salt, I mean, it's mainly a guy, producer called Inflow, and you'll know his music from Little Sims.
Yeah.
I mean, that he produces those records.
And Adele.
And Adele, yeah. I mean, they thought he, I mean, people thought he was going to be enormous when he produced Adele, but he actually had a really bad experience in America and came back to the UK and just started making uncompromising music. And he, I think Salt's, I mean, they do really crazy things, like they release 4 albums in one day. You know, they, and some of these records are like stripped records, just, you know, drums and vocals and some, and then suddenly it'll just erupt into strings.
Yeah.
But he's, you know, he's out there on his own. He's incredible.
Totally fascinating and totally DIY. I mean, you know, it's funny we're here in rough trade, but there's nothing more DIY in the way they did this.
He's about 35 now and, you know, he's just got such a future.
I mean, you know, I think Giles Peterson was probably the guy who championed him. They were hard records to find. You didn't hear them very often, but when you did, boy, they were amazing. I'm now going to go to a track which I've not heard before, and I actually went and bought the album tonight. It's a guy called Steve Lacy, so if we can maybe hear a bit of Steve Lacy's Bad Habit. I don't remember it starting quite this quietly. First come aware of Steve Lacy?
So he was in, he was part of a group called Odd Future, who featured Tyler the Creator. I think he was in a band called The Internet as well. And they're just basically LA music makers who really take their influences from just about everywhere. So we're getting into a stage now where you've got young guys who basically come from hip hop, but they are discovering, you know, Stereolab FM, you know, ELO, all sorts of things, and they're people who want to make music that is dreamy, dream pop, and odd, and unique. Some of his he started making his records on iPhones. I mean, he was like, and he's, you know, these kids know how to do that sort of thing. You know, it's so he's a huge fan of Stereolab, which is really, you know, maybe telling in some of his other music. I mean, this track, Bad Habit, completely falls apart right at the end in a really unusual way, like. The guitars just disappear and the vocals come in a really strange way. But if you listen to those guitars, they're actually really rough.
Yeah.
They're almost like, they sound like they're recorded on 4 tracks. And that's intentional. Yeah. They like that sound. They want to grab that
sound. Am I right in thinking his second album was called Lo-Fi? Is that
quite
right?
Possibly.
You know, that whole concept. And the fact they weren't afraid to take from almost anywhere. You know, they were hearing music that, I guess, inspired them. And it wasn't, you know, something... I mean, I remember going to New York in the late 80s and meeting, you know, the guys from Tommy Boy and Sleeping Bag and a lot of those labels and meeting some of the artists. And you kind of knew where it was coming from, all those breaks and beats. But all of a sudden, these guys are just totally reinventing music that you probably even wouldn't have guessed they'd come across. I mean, it's quite astonishing.
Yeah, I mean, and they're into lo-fi, they're into dream pop, and they are it's a hybrid of hip hop and lo-fi and you know it's very American. It's very American.
Yeah,
very West Coast.
Yeah,
and obviously Tyler is out there sort of kind of charging at the front with all of this.
My son went to UCLA for a year as part of his American history degree and got very excited when he realised one of his lecturers is Tyler's mum. So
amazing.
He comes from a really interesting background. But yeah. As we've mentioned him, we might as well hear a bit of Tyler. I mean, first time I came across Odd Future, which was the band he came out of, my son, they did a pop-up somewhere on Brick Lane here. Selling t-shirts, yeah, I think he still got it. And he came home and he was really excited. Oh, Dad, I think you'd really like this stuff. And it was, the first time he played me some of the music, it was like, wow, where the hell is this coming from? I mean, you could tell it was hip hop, but it was very different. And I mean, you know, Tyler, again, is another person that's taken from all sorts of things. So can we have a bit of the next track?
My son, who's 15, is a huge fan of Tyler, and his mates are as well. Tyler's big in their school. So about a month ago, he was playing the new album.
Yeah.
And I said, Harry, Tyler likes the High Llamas. He went. So on Twitter, I found him a Tyler post about the High Llamas. And he just walked away.
That's fantastic. But no, I mean, it's fascinating where he seems to be taking stuff from. I mean, there's definitely a couple of tracks on that album, which on the fanbug site, I don't know if any of you, it's High Llamas fanbugs on Facebook. And they were talking about, you know, they were trying to pick out the tracks which Tyler had most definitely kind of raided for ideas. And yeah, I mean, just fascinating records. I think, you know, if you can kind of divorce yourself a little bit from what you think maybe hip hop was about, if it's not something that has kind of come across your borders, I mean, fantastic records.
Yeah, I mean, it's really lovely that he acknowledged that he liked the band. I would say he probably didn't raid anything. He was just listening to the same things, like Michel Legrand, I mean, if anybody knows about his clothing brand called, I don't know if Livy was there, should tell me. Then you will hear music which is, you know, very, very, very cinematic, very French. He really understands string arranging, and he understands, you know, how to bring in kind of lovely little kind of way, you know, sine wave synths over string arrangements. And he's got a really good grasp of harmony. Great piano player, absolutely wonderful. Just, you know, what a great guy. And, you know, I mean, the one of the great moments is when May and Liv basically showed me the thing where he said he loved Dorothy Ashby from Cancladis, and he was raving about Tallahomie Way, and he also liked the soundtrack I did for Funny Pages. And it's just wonderful to have somebody like that talking about your music, because you admire them.
Quite astonishing.
Yeah.
You know, fan club that far apart. I thought we'd finish with a track by somebody who's actually on the new High Llamas album. And Sean, I'll explain a bit more about where that relationship came from. So we can have the last track. It's from a guy called Friars.
Baby, have we been here for a long time? Because it's long.
So Sean, tell us about Friars.
Llamas. Okay, how did you meet?
Ben Garrett is a producer, and I met him a long time ago when he turned up at my house with Ray Morris, who he's now married to. And at that time, he was producing her for Warner Brothers. I was supposed to do some strings. The strings didn't happen. Ben disappeared. Well, he didn't completely disappear. He kept in touch with me, and you know, we both love football together, and we kept in touch a little bit. He married Ray, and in about 2018, maybe, he got in touch and said, "I'm going to make a record, and I would love you to be the arranger, or you know, just the other person on the record."
Yeah.
And so I was suddenly, and so at this time, and as I explained before, I'm already listening to this music that is just really, you know, reviving my interest in contemporary music. And I'm suddenly in the room with this guy who's 32, he's 32 years younger than me, or no, 30 years younger than me. He plays, I walk into his studio and I said, "It's brilliant. I love what you're doing, Ben. Turn it down, please. Turn it down," because I just couldn't hear anything. Everything was so loud, and when things are really loud, you can't actually hear detail. So the first thing I asked him to do was to play things quietly, and he has this incredible. He's a quick producer. He's got a great melodic ear. A great. He's worked with so many people in modern, Mark Ronson, Billy Allen, Dave, lots of different people. He's a pop R&B producer who's this incredibly incisive, intelligent guy. And he just let me work, just do what I do on his records. But I learned so much. He was learning about arrangement from me, and I was learning a lot about how to make contemporary music for him. So we exchanged these couple of years, and I was in the studio with him when we made his wife's record, Rachel in Fairyland. Some of you may have been here when Ray Morris did the show here. I actually played with her, and it was. And I'm indebted to those two people. And Friars mixed the record, mixed Hey Panda. He's shouting in a beautifully kind of crazy way all over the record. Ray's on the record and Sister's Friends.
Yeah.
So this is a, you know, this is a lifelong friendship. And I would say that if I have three, the first musical relationship that really affected me was Carl Cochran and Micro Disney. Yeah. The second one was Tim Gain at Stereo Lab. And the third one is Ben Garrett. You know, he's there, so, you know.
I can add to that, just because I didn't have anything to do with it. The Rachel in Fairyland album is the greatest British pop record ever made, and it disappeared without trace. So if you haven't heard that, I would recommend it really strongly. Yeah. About 2 years old now.
Yeah. And the record that Friars made was God Melodies. And so if you haven't heard either of those, it's something you might want to.
And one way you can hear a lot more of this stuff, Sean and Liv have put together a number of great playlists on Spotify.
And a Quobuzz one.
There's lots of ways of kind of getting your head around this stuff. I know certainly some of my friends find it kind of daunting because they don't come from listening to this sort of stuff. But, you know, I think it's kind of fascinating. Also, some of you men enjoy, you did a great podcast with Rocks Back Pages recently, which digs back into some, you know, some earlier things.
Last Wednesday I had a very enjoyable 2 hours with Bonnie Hoskins and Mark
Jasper.
Pringle and Jasper. We got through an awful lot of stuff.
It's worth it just for the,
I think it's the most
the Lee pieces.
The most interesting discussion about the Beach Boys that I've been involved with, where we really sort of got into the kind of the darker side of the Beach Boys in a really great way. And if you haven't heard that, I haven't heard it all yet because it only came out today. I heard a little bits and pieces. I talk about my mother a lot.
And not allowing you to read the enemy.
Yeah, God bless her. God bless her in heaven, looking down at us.
She ran a kiosk.
She did. I wasn't allowed. I sold the enemy, but I wasn't allowed to read it.
Brilliant. Are we allowed to mention there's some gigs coming up?
Hopefully.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's a way off. I mean, there are shows planned for October, and so tonight was very much like stepping into a pool and seeing if we can actually play live as a band again and play some of this music. And we'll be going away and doing our homework and sort of learning more songs and trying to sort of, try to do this. And it's really enjoyable. So, there'll be lots more of this. And, I think there will be, Hey Panda and the older stuff in a set that will roll out. There'll probably be something somewhere before October. So just keep
your eyes open, people.
Yeah.
Cool. We're probably going to get throttled by the Rough Trade staff, right. So I think we probably need to end. Sean, I think he'll probably be moving. We're writing the thing towards the front of the stall to do some signings.
Just maybe, if I go.
Well, actually, I'm thinking maybe ask Sean the question.
Yeah.
John, and if you want to ask questions, down there.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because we're going to run out of time otherwise. Yeah.
So listen, everybody came out tonight and joined us, and just say thank you very much to Nick for setting this up.
It was a lot of fun, and actually, what fascinated me is the range of music that's inspired the High Llamas.
Yeah.
Okay. And I don't hear that in too many other groups. I'm sure we're not going to get it from. Yeah. Mr. John Squire and Mr. Gallagher.
So thanks for everybody.
Yeah. Thanks, Nick. Yeah. Thanks everybody. Thanks
to John and Marcus and Olivia who are up there listening.